Thank you for joining the online worship service of Waynesboro Grace. Our mission is to glorify God by making disciple-making disciples. For more information about our church, you can find us online at waynesborograce.org or on Facebook at Waynesboro Grace.
All of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come, even so come. Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride church ready for you, every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come, even so come, Lord Jesus, come.
Rising, eyes are turning your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, we
morning, Lord, that you are Lord of all, that the weak are made strong through you, and that you are a solid rock. No matter what we face, you will not crumble, and we can find our strength in you. In your name, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. I have a few more people coming up with me. A few months ago, we sat down with all the youth group and we asked them, what would they like to do for service projects? And one of the first things that they came up with was they wanted to do something for our elders as a thank you. So yesterday we got together and we all baked cookies and wrote thank you cards. So if all the elders could come up, and Damien, because you've been leading us just as much as they have, we just want to let you guys know that you are appreciated, and we thank you for everything that you've done for us and leading us. Kevin, we need you too. Oh, it's the mask. I thought you were still out there.
Hi, Daddy.
So, thank you for everything that you do for our church and in shepherding us and leading us. Like I said, you guys are very appreciated. All right, go ahead.
Children know that these platters of cookies have our names on them and not their names on them. So, well, thank you very much, youth group. We are grateful for that and grateful for the opportunity we have to gather this morning. It was about 6.5 years ago, roughly speaking, that closer to six, my family and I moved into town. And one of the first things we did as I began working here was hear about pregnancy ministries, and that was largely through what Joyce was telling me as she was trying to get me up to speed on everything that was going on. And when you work at a church for 45 years and have had the opportunity to break in several pastors, she knew exactly what she was doing and was hoping to get me caught up to speed quickly. And then it became Cinda and her opportunity to help me understand a little bit more of PMI. And so Carrie and I said, we got to go and meet those individuals. And so at that point in time, Carrie was great with child. We were weeks away from Tucker being delivered, and so we're talking the whole belly, I probably shouldn't be describing that to you. But we walked over, and we had Allegra with us, and Adelaide's in a stroller. We've got Tucker in the womb, and we walk in, and I think the first thing we said was, "Hi, we're pro-life, and we're here because I work just up the street and would love for our church to be involved in your ministry and would love to have the opportunity to meet you." And we, over the last several years, have done a variety of things, baby bottles, 5K walks, different things as family, different things as a church family. And it was at the beginning of 2020, maybe the end of 2019, that I saw on a prayer list that Joyce had included that PMI needed a building director for Waynesboro's office and a building. And that really, really unsettled me. And I was very, very unsatisfied that PMI was not any longer in Waynesboro. And began thinking and praying with several of you about what it might look like to bring them to Waynesboro again. And so we get to do that here this morning, and I'll be joined by Linda Barr, who is the one running the helm. Come on up here, Linda, and she's going to tell us a little bit about PMI. And I asked her if she would pretend that none of us know anything about PMI, in case one of you know nothing about PMI. And so, Linda, what is PMI? What do you do? What are you trying to do? And what is your ministry about?
This is on. Okay, it is on. Okay.
Well, Pregnancy Ministries is a Christ-centered ministry who seeks to reach out to those with unplanned pregnancies to uphold the sanctity of human life in pregnancy and in pregnancy-related areas. We began in 1985, so 35 years ago, and in a small office in Chambersburg, and we've grown now to have a center also in Shippensburg and Greencastle. We also do abortion recovery ministry and also do STI testing. But our main focus is to reach out to those in unplanned pregnancies who may be struggling as to whether they want to carry their child to term. And we know Hagerstown is right across the border, just a few steps away, and there is an abortion clinic there. So I know Greencastle and Waynesboro are so important to have a center in those particular locations because of that. And so we will offer a free pregnancy test to those women and talk to them about pregnancy options, give them education on abortion, because a lot of women, abortion is just a term that means an easy way out of a pregnancy, and that's the only thing that they're thinking about in their situation. And to bring to them the reality of what abortion actually is, the long-term effects that it can have. Not just there can be some physical complications, but emotional and spiritual complications are there as well. And so we want to bring those realities to them, those truths. We also have free ultrasound confirmation in Chambersburg, and any of the clients from any of the areas can go to the Chambersburg Center and schedule to have a free ultrasound confirmation. And with that, there is the reality of what is happening inside of them. For many of those women, they're going to see that little baby bouncing around inside. and we have even seen the impact that it can have just for a woman to see and to be shown. There is the beating heart of the baby. So even though there's not that much to see, it can have an influence and an impact on what her decision is. And so it will also give her an idea of how far along she is, because we've had women who've come in and who thought, well, I'm not that far along. And they come in, and here they find out they're 7 or 8 weeks pregnant, and that little baby is, you know, moving around in the womb. And that, of course, has a tremendous impact on their decision.
Yeah, wow, wow. Just tremendous to think about. I mean, you're talking about those images and those sounds, and I'm back in the room when we first heard those sounds and saw those images, and those are just powerful, powerful moments. What needs does the Waynesboro office have? I mean, we got a building. You're gonna get keys today, but it doesn't end here. It really hopefully begins here. So what's next, maybe in terms of the plan, and what particular specific needs does the Waynesboro office have?
Sure. Well, the biggest need would be for Waynesboro directors. So you could pray. We have received some applications for that. So just be praying as, you know, we interview and as the decision is made for a Waynesboro Center director. We'll also need to make some renovations and all there. And one of the next steps, along with the Waynesboro Center director, is having perhaps the director, but our abortion recovery director, Ruth, will have her office there. So have her come in. And she has a daughter who has done office design.
Oh, cool.
And so she is going to come in and say, okay, I know what you're about. I know what you do. And this is my vision for what the office could look like. And once we have those and can set some specifics, then see what kind of renovations will need to be done to work it. There shouldn't be a whole lot that needs to be done, just some sprucing up and maybe a wall here and counter here or something like that. But get all that, and then we'll have an idea of what the cost will be and what we have now and what will be needed in the future.
Yeah.
And we'll also need, obviously, volunteers. And as we see what will be coming in that we have stored up in Chambersburg, then we'll be able to see what we'll need as far as the baby and maternity needs for the women.
Mm. Well, very good.
Yeah. And I will say that we have a program called Earn While You Learn, and the girls come in during their pregnancy and receive education. They go through these sessions to learn about healthy pregnancies and taking care of babies. And as they do that, there are also some parenting videos if they have older children. And as they go through those sessions, they earn baby bucks, and they can use those baby bucks to get the things that they need. Maternity clothes, baby furniture items, diapers, wipes, things
sure.
like that.
Okay, very good. Very good. As you think about people, perhaps more at an individual level in regards to volunteers, are there some top of the list things that individuals, perhaps even from our church, could be thinking about as ways to further engage with PMI?
Sure. Okay. Well, the most crucial need will be for client advocates, those who meet one-on-one with the girls, as well as receptionists who are in the office to greet, to do the preliminaries, answer the phone, and so forth. And we do have training for those. It's about a 20-25-hour training that we'll do, and we're looking to do a specific training just for Waynesboro. Mm. That's the goal. That's the vision right
sure.
now.
Sure.
And we also need other people to help, sort baby clothing, launder baby clothing. Mm. That's very easy. You pick it up at the office, take it home, launder it, bring it back all fresh. Clean up the baby furniture items, go through them. Even clean the office. Mm. Like, we usually have people who come in about once a month or twice a month, something like that, to, spruce up the office, give it a good cleaning.
Oh, very good. So, Waynesboro, I want you to be thinking about what you might be able to do. There might be some hours in your week that could be invested in the building behind us and in this tremendous ministry. I'd love for you to just be thinking and praying about that and what that might look like. Because I would love for us to not just be a landlord, but to be a partner, and for us to be very much supportive and involved. And if we can, at some point, in appropriate ways, have a presence in the office to where we're able to say, hey, I go to church just right behind here, and we'd love to have you join us. It could be a tremendous opportunity for witness and to just in partnership with PMI. And so I'd love for you to be thinking about that, to be praying about that, because those are some tremendous, tremendous opportunities. So on the table here, we have a contract for us, contract for you. There's also a receiving blanket and some things. This is one of many, actually. And church, these were handmade by Joyce Rosenberger. So some of you will know that name. Others of you have not ever had the privilege of meeting Herb or Joyce, because they have they're a little older and their health is failing. But I visited them about a week ago, and they were talking about how Joyce made all of these blankets and baby items, and she used to give them to her daughter, who worked in a hospital, and they would get distributed out to individuals as they had need. But COVID changed that, and those things can't happen in that same way. And they said, do you know anybody that might need baby blankets and booties and hats? And I said, you know what? Let me tell you about what we're doing a week from now. And so I walked out of there with a whole box of these. And we've got more in the office. But just in thinking about how, as a church body, God's been working and orchestrating this, even to the details of a beloved saint who is not able to physically be here, but is still able to knit. And from what I understand, she is a prolific knitter, that's probably crochet, actually. Thank you. Your work's not done. There's still more to do, Joyce. I still need help. Prolific in her ability to do these items. And for us to walk out with a box full of these things, I just think it's really, really neat. So, hey, Waynesboro Grace team, PMI team, could you come up here? We want to sign these things, and then I'm going to ask for one representative from PMI to pray, and then a representative from our elder team as well to pray. So if you received a box of cookies earlier, you should be making your way up here, okay? Just to be clear. So elder team, that would be you. Come on up. My guys are running slow this morning. You guys haven't sugar crashed already. Oh, there they are. There they are. All right. Well, very good. So can we sign? Do you have the right people?
We actually don't have the right
people. Okay, fair enough.
But we can fake it.
All right.
Actually, they have obligations at their church.
Understood. So I think it was going to be John and Kevin from us. So, guys, why don't you go ahead and do that? And there's two copies there. You guys can sign, and we'll ask them to do it. It's on the very, very back page, which is, there you go.
Yeah. And these are two of our board members. This is Sarah Hollinshead and Barb Hummer. Barb, you're secretary. What are you? Assistant secretary. Okay, there you go. I'm like, okay, my mind.
Oh, very good. Very good. All right, well, you guys got one more to do, but yeah. So, and Linda, we'll just give these to you,
okay,
and you can take
them
and have
the correct signatures.
Yep, fair enough. Fair enough. Very good. All right, Kevin. All right, cool. Well, would you or one of your team members lead us in prayer? And guys, if one of you would just come and grab the mic and be ready to go when they are done, that would be great. Go right ahead.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, what magnificent opportunity you have placed before us, the church as well as PMI. Lord, how you have answered prayers and brought Pastor Tim and his leadership team to lead us in the offering of their building. Your grace in doing this is just amazing for us. We thank you for their willing hearts and hands, Lord, as they even now explore different ways to help us beyond the building. We pray, Lord, that PMI would be a bright light in a dark place as our culture continues to darken around us. We know, Lord, that this church on this hill will be a light for you, and as well we ask that PMI would be that as well, as we not only seek to meet the material and emotional needs of these young women and men who come to us, but their spiritual needs as well. Lord, we just ask your blessing on this union between us, and that you would hear our prayers for a center director as well as volunteers and all the other things that come into play. We thank you for Linda and her leadership and for Pastor Tim as they have worked out the many details regarding this partnership. We ask most of all, Lord, that this union, Lord, and that PMI in Waynesboro would bring honor and glory to your name. Thank you, Lord. In your name we pray.
God, you said that many are the plans of man's heart, but the counsel of the Lord is the same. And we praise you and thank you as we think back over the years, the different ways that building has been used and the way that you have used it to support our ministry. At Grace, and the questions
PMI is a ministry that remembers that it's an issue that impacts souls, it impacts lives, it impacts real people. And so we pray for the ministry of PMI and our ability to support it, ultimately that it would glorify you and point those people, those souls to Jesus Christ. And we ask these things in Jesus' name.
Amen. Well, hey, would you say good morning and welcome to those around you, please?
Seven churches, one province. Seven churches, one apocalypse. Seven churches, one Savior. Seven churches, one revelation.
All right. Well, if you could begin making your way back to your seats, and as you do, grab your Bibles, that would be great. And we're going to keep on in Revelation chapter 2 together this morning, and we're going to be finishing chapter 2 this morning and thinking about and looking at the letter that Jesus writes to the church of Thyatira. And to be quite honest, this particular passage of Scripture has all of the hallmark characteristics of one of those sets of verses that could get a preacher really, really excited and riled up and finding lots of occasions to yell and scream. And it wouldn't be for good or for poor reasons. I mean, there are plenty of reasons for this passage to be one that does make it exciting in that regard. But I want us to rather consider the heart of God in this text. And in particular, I want us to think about what it is that Jesus commends the church for and what it is he instructs them to do. And what we're going to see in this set of verses is that the vast majority of the church in Thyatira had found themselves all in regards to the idol worship of the day and all of the trappings and activities that would have been included in that. And there were some that had held out. And we don't know how many had held out, but there were some that had held out. And the instructions that Jesus gives them beginning in verse 24 are significant, and quite frankly, did not plan for this to be the case, but I think what we're doing this morning ends up being a case in point application of the very instructions Jesus tells the church, or the holdouts in the church, to continue doing. In some regards, we're going to have to try to understand what exactly is meant by idol worship, food sacrificed to idols, and sexual immorality. To do so, we're going to step back into the Old Testament for a few moments as well. But the city of Thyatira was not a city well known for really much of anything. It was a city that did not have the prominence of Pergamum, which had used to have been a capital city. It did not have the prowess or beauty of Smyrna. It did not have the fanfare and cultural trappings or exuberance of Ephesus. It was really, by and large, a little known town, perhaps a sleepy town, you might call it. It was the smallest of all the seven cities in these letters that Jesus writes a letter to, and it was located in a valley. And so, unlike the other three cities that we've thought about so far, Thyatira had no natural defense against invaders. And the other cities where there would have been a hill, or it would have been built on a hillside, or there would have been harbors of port that they could have utilized for military might, Thyatira had none of that. And in large regard, Thyatira functioned as the city that was supposed to delay the attack on Pergamum. So Pergamum functioned as a capital city in the area and in the province of Asia for several hundred years before Jesus was born. And then Ephesus took over that claim to fame. But you have Pergamum functioning as this capital city, and it was about 30 to 40 miles from Thyatira. And Thyatira then had one job, and that one job was to stop or delay the armies that were going to try and invade the capital city long enough that all of the military might of the capital city could get mustered. So if you were stationed in Thyatira, you had a bad day. It was bad duty to get stationed there, because it meant you were going to get overrun. And your one job was to hold out long enough so that the scouts could get up to Pergamum and warn the others. It didn't have a whole lot of claim to fame. As it progressed, Thyatira actually became known for trade guilds. It began and found a way to export goods. And actually, one of the leading ladies of the church in Philippi, whose name was Lydia, we're told in Acts chapter 16, was from Thyatira. And she was, as Luke records, a seller of purple goods. And so Thyatira had a textile industry. It was known for exporting linens and garments and these textiles, as well as wood, leather, bronze. They would have dyed these things. They would have had some exporting of clay. There would have been bakeries involved. There would have been food industries to some regard. But it's interesting that Thyatira was known at the time this letter was written as a city that had tremendous guilds. Now, for us to try to understand what a guild was, just think of modern-day unions. They had organized themselves into certain labor unions or guilds, and more than likely, you didn't function in the economy unless you were participating in one of these guilds. It's interesting as well, as different commentators have written about Thyatira, in contrast to the other three cities, at least, that we've looked at, nobody really knows what the situation in Thyatira was. You can kind of sketch out what was going on in Ephesus, because that's the church mentioned in the scriptures more than any other churches mentioned in the scriptures. You can kind of sketch what was happening in Smyrna because of some other historical documents that record for us the martyrdom that characterized Smyrna. You can sketch a little bit historically of what was happening in Pergamum because there are still massive archaeological relics from that day in Pergamum that still exist and are on display for us to go and visit if we would so desire. Nobody really knows what was going on in Thyatira and what was happening historically and culturally and socioeconomically at this point in time. What we do have is some of the strongest words that Jesus gives. And what we do have is a very clear condemnation of the church's activity and a clear articulation of the compromise the church fell into. And what we'll see in these verses is we'll see that the commendation of the church is expressed. We'll see the compromise of the church expressed. We'll see then the consequences that Jesus says that compromise will bring with it. But then we'll also see the conquering faithfulness of those who have not followed suit. And we're not going to spend a tremendous amount of time in any one of those because I want us to try to get our minds wrapped around a little bit more of what was happening in the city to the best we are able. And we do so from thinking about the designation that Jesus gives regarding the false teacher that was leading many, if not most, in this church to compromise. So before we go any further, let's pray. And then we'll hop into the text and we'll try to understand what is going on and think through what it is that applies to us. Well, God, we bow now and we ask that you would give us the ears to hear, the eyes to see. God, we want to understand what it is that you have said. And we want to understand what it is that you want us to understand. God, we're not just here this morning to spend a half an hour or 45 minutes together just staring at words on a page. We're here this morning to hear from you as you speak through these words that are living and active. And so, God, give us what it is that we need. God, help us to see, help us to hear, help us to understand. And we pray this in Jesus' good name. Amen. We'll look at verse 18 there in Revelation chapter 2. Jesus begins, "And to the angel of the church in Thyatira write the words of the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire and whose feet are burnished bronze." Now, that imagery of eyes like a flame of fire was probably representative imagery to say the eyesight is piercing and it's accurate. And so when Jesus is going to outline for the church what it is that they are not doing well, he's going to do so having the eyesight and the ability to make a right judgment. His eyesight is piercing, but it's also going to be perfect. And the imagery of burnished bronze would be a more of a symbol of might and yet also purity. And the idea of purity was something the Thyatirans would have been able to get their minds wrapped around, having been exporters or being exporters of bronze. Because burnished bronze would be bronze that had been purified. It'd be bronze that had its impurities heated out of it. And in large respect, that's exactly what Jesus is saying is going to come to the church if they don't change course. And so he comes with perfect piercing eyesight, and he comes with refining fire, and he begins to then outline for them what he commends them for. "I know your works, your love and faith and service and patient endurance, and that your later works exceed the first." The list he gives of commendations is very closely related to the list that he gives to the church in Ephesus. But like the church in Ephesus that did not have love, the Thyatirans do. So they're doing the things externally, you might say, that a church is supposed to do. And yet Jesus, once again, is going to utter those three little letters in our English Bibles that provide a stark contrast between what he commends and where it is they've compromised. "But," he says, "I have this against you, that you tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess and is teaching and seducing my servants to practice sexual immorality and to eat food sacrificed to idols. I gave her time to repent, but she refuses to repent of her sexual immorality. And behold, I will throw her onto a sickbed. And those who commit adultery with her, I will throw into great tribulation unless they repent of her works. And I will strike her children dead, and all the churches will know that I am he who searches the mind and heart, piercing, penetrating eyesight, and will give to each of you according to your works." That's some strong language from Jesus. And you might be able to see where those words would and have excited many of individuals preaching through these verses. But I want us to try to unpack and understand in the few minutes we have together this morning this representation or this identification Jesus makes by the name Jezebel. We don't know if there was actually someone named Jezebel, or if that just became a way to most easily summarize the teaching and the practices of whoever was the well-known woman teaching and seducing and refusing to repent and follow. But it is an incredibly loaded designation. It's an incredibly loaded name. And if you've ever heard of Elijah and the prophets on Mount Carmel, that dynamic scene in the Old Testament where the prophets of Baal and the prophets of Asherah are there in staggering numbers. I believe there's 850 of them in attendance, and they're trying to get Baal's attention to consume the altar, and it doesn't happen. And Elijah says, "All right, God, your turn," and it's gone. That event happened because of Jezebel. And we see in 1 Kings 16, 30 to 33, King Ahab, the son of Omri, did evil in the sight of the Lord more than all who were before him. He was a bad king. There's some bad kings that had preceded Ahab, but he stood out head and shoulders above the rest in his evil. And as if it had been a light thing for him to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, he took for his wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians. And then look what Ahab does. He went and served Baal and worshipped him. He erected an altar for Baal in the house of Baal, which he built in Samaria, the capital city of the northern kingdom, where his home would have resided, where he was supposed to be the leader of purity for the Israelites, and following the word and the law and the commands of the Lord, erects an altar to a false god, worships the false god, builds him a house. And Ahab made an Asherah. And Ahab did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than all the kings of Israel who were before him. It's a tremendous, tremendous summary statement. Let me try to explain a little bit of what's going on here, and I think we might have a chance of understanding why God's anger was so provoked. I don't know about you, but oftentimes when I hear the words idol worship, the first image that pops into my mind is a little statue or figurine that you might stick somewhere in your home. And to be sure, there's idol worship that takes that form and that place. And there have been restaurants that I've walked into where there's a little Buddha around there. And they have some things that they're doing. And more of it's cultural at times, because there was a restaurant owned by Christians who had a Buddha there. And it just was weird. But we, at least in my estimation, consider idol worship to be and take more of that form. That wasn't really the case here. It may have been part of the case, but it wasn't the whole case. The Asherah that is referenced there in verse 33 was a pole made out of wood, made out of perhaps another form of material that would have been on the top of a hill. And so when you see in the Old Testament the words high places, where they went and worshipped at the high places, is what shows up. That these poles would have sat atop the high places, and these poles would have either represented or would have been shaped or formed into the form of male reproductive genitalia. And there's really one thing you did at the top of the hill below the pole. And so when Ahab erects an altar and bends his knee and builds a house to Baal and makes a pole, the anger of the Lord was provoked because babies were being killed. Now that may sound like a gigantic leap, and I haven't really traced out exactly why that would have been my conclusion, but let me try to explain it to you. Baal was a fertility god. He was a god that you worshipped and bowed down to and tried to get the attention of so that you had good fertility. You went and you worshipped and you bent your knee and you served him so that you would have the right line and lineage for your family to carry on its name, for your descendants to inherit the land that you would have been promised. You worshipped Baal at the high places, underneath the Asherah poles, doing fertility things. Well, in a society where there is no form or fashion of birth control, contraception is thousands of years from even being considered. What happens is women get pregnant. And if you look at the worship practices then of Baal, it did not just include the activities taking place at the top of a hill beneath the Asherah pole. But the majority of these ancient Near Eastern gods also had child sacrifice rites. And that never made sense to me until I kind of began putting the pieces together. And what you would have would be men and women going up to the high places to worship and serve Baal to try to find whatever favor he may bestow on them so they would have the right line and lineage in their family to carry on the family name. But, oh, what happens when those things take place? Well, babies are conceived. But now we have a bunch of babies that we don't want. Because those aren't the babies we want. We didn't want a baby with a cultic prostitute that happened at the top of a hill underneath an Asherah pole. We wanted a legitimate son or daughter. We were just asking Baal for his favor to give us the legitimate seed. And yet we find ourselves now with child. And so Chemosh, Moloch, Baal, all had practices in child sacrifice. And it's what you would have done with the babies you didn't want. And it was a demonic out clause for these families that found themselves with pregnancies they weren't looking for as they worshiped a god they were more than willing to serve. I believe God's anger was provoked towards Ahab more than any other king before because he systematized the worship of Baal and the sacrifice of babies. Solomon cracked the door open. If you go to 1 Kings chapter 11, you see what happened at the very end of Solomon's tenure on the throne. He cracked the door open with his 700 wives and 300 concubines. And we're told there that his heart was led from the Lord because he was led to worship and serve other gods. So it wasn't that Ahab was the first. It's that he systematized it. And he did so at the prompting of his wife Jezebel. This will actually become, not this moment per se, but what happens after and out of these moments where child sacrifice is now a part of the nation of Israel. This will be one of the things that Jeremiah records that the nation was specifically thrown into captivity by the Babylonians for. God sends the Babylonians to put them into captivity for 70 years because they refused to follow him. And one of the very things that are identified as what led the Lord to do that was their child sacrifice. Now, in today's world, we don't have poles. Nothing's happening at High Rock. There might be things happening at High Rock, but it's not at least systematized like it might have been at these high places. The God perhaps is different. It may not go by the name of Baal. It may go by the name of me. But I would submit to you that, as we are told in Genesis 3, that the serpent, Satan, will set his face and be against the seed of the woman. That is an indication to his hatred for Jesus that would one day come. But that is also an indication of his hatred for birth and for life. And you see that take its form in Cain and Abel. And you see that begin to take its form through the religious worship practices of these ancient Near Eastern communities. And Ahab systematized it because he married a woman named Jezebel who led his heart far, far away. And so to understand what Jesus has to say to the church in Thyatira, where he says, you're tolerating this woman, Jezebel. This is a loaded statement. And we don't have records and the explanation to draw all of those parallel conclusions into the city of Thyatira. But we do have Jesus saying, the woman, the false teacher you're listening to, who's teaching you and seducing you and refusing to repent, is of the character of the woman Jezebel. And Jesus pronounces some very, very strong consequences.
With this heart open wide from the depths, from the heights, I will bring a sacrifice. With these hands lifted high, hear my song, hear my cry, I will bring a sacrifice. I will bring sacrifice. I lay me down, I'm not my own, I belong to you alone. Lay me down, lay me down. Oh, hand on my heart, this much is true, there's no life apart from you. Lay me down, lay me down. Letting go of my pride, giving up all my rights, take this life and let it shine, 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 shine. Take this life and let it shine. I lay me down, I'm not my own, I belong to you alone. Lay me down, lay me down. There's no life apart from you. Lay me down, lay me down. Oh, lay me down, lay me down, lay me down.
It will be my joy to say, your will, your way. It will be my joy to say, your will, your way. It will be my joy to say, your will, your way, always.
It will be my joy to say, your will, your way. It will be my joy to say, your will, your way. It will be my joy to say, your will, your way. Always.
is so hard to deny ourselves and to put your will before our will, Lord. It is natural for us to be selfish. And Lord, we just pray that we would find truth and your strength to say your will, not our will, and to have joy while we say it. In your name, amen. Well, thank you all for coming. It was great worshiping with you this morning. Have a great week. You are dismissed.
Thanks again for joining us, and be sure to check out